Ladies and gentlemen, and distinguished guests, first of all, a very warm welcome to all of you at this very special 50th Jubilee Lecture. To all our guests and members, especially here in the Royal Society, but especially tonight, we're doing a first for IFST in that we have six regional receptions around the country. We've called them our street parties, and I'm hoping as I speak, the six street parties can hear me and see me. So a big hello to the Northern Ireland branch at Moy Park, the Midlands branch from both Derby Quad and Harper Adams, Scotland are in Glasgow at the Institute of Electrical Engineers, South Eastern are at Henley on Thames, and Western branch are at the Bristol Planetarium. So as I'm sure you're all aware, this is our very special Jubilee year in 2014. And to mark this occasion, we have organised a number of very special events throughout the year. And I'm very delighted tonight that we do have this web link, which I'm a bit nervous about and fingers crossed it's working. But it does mean that as well as the 150 odd people here, we have about 400 guests right around the UK joining us this evening. We've had a great year so far as our Jubilee celebrations. We have a number of special projects and events already happened. At our House of Lords reception in July, we formally launched our Register of Food Safety Professionals. This is a significant new development which will provide much needed professional status and recognition for all food safety professionals. Our new register is in effect four different registers reflecting the different levels of responsibility. And they have been developed especially to accredit relevant education and experience so that businesses can better recognise and develop their own food safety professionals, specialists in-house. With professional registration, as you would expect, we also have to ensure the need for compliance with a good code of professional conduct and also a requirement to maintain effective CPD, continuing professional development. So the register has been designed to recognise food safety professionals right throughout the food chain, from primary production and processing through to retailing, and with so much emphasis at the moment on food safety integrity and fraud prevention, our register and the associated support we plan to deliver, we think will provide much needed assurance to the sector. If you want to know more about the registers, please speak to myself or any of the team here tonight. Now, another important launch for IFST recently has been our Jubilee project, Food Start, and you've all got leaflets about Food Start on your chairs this evening. This is a unique web-based facility where food employers can offer and manage their placements, be they secondary school, work experience placements, through to undergraduate placements, internships, even holiday jobs. And it's all completely free of charge. Students who are using the Food Start website will be able to browse for placements, log and track their individual experiences, and build their own very special portfolio of experience, which we think will give a perfect springboard to their future career in the food sector. The Food Start website is now live. It was on www.foodstart.org.uk, and it has been made possible thanks to a number of very generous financial supporters, including Warburton's, Waitrose, the Cornelius Group, Adeli, FTC, Barfoots, R Biopharm Roan, Leatherhead Food Research, Camden BRI, and DVNGL. We're really delighted at this response so far, and we want to thank all those IFST members who've also given personal donations to make this project a reality and a long-lasting legacy for the Institute. We're very pleased that, to report that Jamie Oliver has also given his support by encouraging all food employers to use Food Start. So if you haven't done so already, please make sure you register and your company online and start posting your placements. Students are always looking for placements. So right away, you go back tomorrow. And it's not too late to support with a donation if you so wish. We'll help to promote this opportunity to all the universities. Just before I introduce our guest speaker, I would like to say a few thank yous. Firstly, to our main lecture sponsor, DVNGL, and our Jubilee sponsors who are shown on the screen behind me. Also to all the sponsors of our regional events, which are identified in the programme. I want to especially thank all the IFST members who have volunteered their time and put in so much effort to arrange the street parties around the six different areas of the UK. And lastly, and but not least, a very, very special thanks to the IFST home team, who have worked really hard to pull this together for us. So enough from me. It's now my great pleasure to introduce our very special guest this evening, Mark Price, CVO, Managing Director of Waitrose. A little bit of information about Mark. He graduated from Lancaster University with a degree in archaeology, and he joined the John Lewis Partnership as a graduate trainee in 1982. And I'm told there's an interesting story behind that, which I'm going to find out later on, I hope, over a drink at the end. He worked his way up through the ranks of John Lewis, eventually becoming Managing Director of Waitrose in April 2007. In August 2013, alongside his Waitrose MD role, Mark also was made Deputy Chairman of the John Lewis Partnership. He holds a number of external appointments. In January 2011, he became Chairman of Business in the Community, a post which he will hold until next year. He is also Chairman of the Prince's Countryside Fund and Deputy Chairman of Channel 4. He was appointed a Commander of the Royal Victorian Order in his New Year's Honours for the work, New Year's Honours for his work with the business in the community and the Prince's Countryside Fund, hence the CVO after his name. I thought it was a Chief Veterinary Officer when I first saw it. Coming from Northern Ireland, we have a CVO. So tonight's Mark's lecture is entitled Constant Values in a Changing World, after which we'll be opening up the reception to questions both here in the Royal Society and also from around the regions. Ladies and gentlemen, Mark Price.
Thank you all very much. How wonderful it would be to be a Chief Veterinary Officer. Well, I have to say, it feels very special to be invited here to give this lecture on the celebration of your 50th year, your Jubilee. I seem to be celebrating a lot of 50ths at the moment. It was my wife's 50th birthday last week, and so it seems particularly appropriate to come and talk to you as well on your 50 years. Margaret, thank you for your kind introduction. Thank you for inviting me. John as well, thank you very much for inviting me. I thought quite a lot about what I was going to say tonight. And in the end, I decided that I would talk about what's happening in the moment in the world of food retailing and Waitrose's response to that, but also the other general responses to that. And in thinking about what I was going to say, I was reminded of the Chinese curse, may he live in interesting times. And we certainly live in extraordinary times for food retail. To remind you, over the course of the last few months, Tesco, for their half year, announced that their profits were down 41% and their like-for-like trading in the UK was down nearly 5%. Morrisons, at their half year results in August, said their profits were down 51%, and then with exceptionals down even more than that, and their like-for-likes were down 7%. Iceland, who reported their full year figures in March, said that their profits were down 11%. The Co-op, in their first half year, made a loss of £9 million. In the corresponding half year, they made profits of circa £110 million. And tomorrow, Sainsbury's announced their half year figures, and it's widely expected that their profits will be down double digit and their sales are down. I mean, quite extraordinary that all of those giants should find life so incredibly difficult. So what's going on? Well, one top analyst in our sector, Clive Black, has described the industry now as uninvestable. And I suspect he's probably right, because nobody knows where these things are going to bottom out. So what's it down to? I would probably start by talking about the discounters. And I think it's worth remembering that up until 2010, the German discounters weren't making a profit in the UK, even though they'd been trading on these shores for almost two decades. In 2008, you'll remember that Tesco decided that they were Britain's biggest discounter, and that seemed to make life really difficult for the discounters, even at the start of the recession, to make real headway. And it wasn't until really 2010, 2011 that Aldi, Lidl, etc. started to see very strong growth. I think that there were two things that happened that gave oxygen to the discounters at that time. I think one was Morrison's looking to move up market, to miss their vegetables and do a whole host of other things with their range. And the other was Tesco similarly taking approach to invest in their stores, to take them up market, to move into Hool and Harris. And I think those two things by two players who'd worked so hard to stop the discounter growth actually allowed oxygen. And from that point, you've seen Aldi grow by 30% a year. You've seen Lidl grow by 16% a year. And now, all of those large retailers really have no option but to march back down the hill and to become more price competitive in order to win customers back. You've seen Morrison's make announcements about that. You've had a pledge from Tesco. Asda made that move a year, year and a half ago. And I'm pretty sure tomorrow, when Sainsbury's talk about their half-year results, they will equally say they need to do more to match the discounter prices. Now, there's one other thing that's happening at the moment, which you will all be very aware of, and that's commodity prices are falling. Not just food commodity prices, beef, lamb, all down by about 10%, poultry down by 10%, milk commodity prices down by about 10%. We're seeing some vegetable commodities down by more than double digit. And then, of course, you've got all the energies, gas 20%, crude oil down by 27%, diesel down by 17%. All of this means that input costs are lower. That's creating a cycle of deflation. And for the first time in almost three decades, what we have at the moment is deflation in food. Now, what the food retailers have been relying on for a long time now is inflation of between 3 and 5%. That's enabled them to keep growing. So since the start of the recession in 2008, what we saw in non-food retailing was space coming out of the market. There was a contraction in non-food retail space. It contracted by about 12% over 5 years, from 2008 to 2013. By contrast, food retail space continued to grow at 3 to 5% every year. Fine when you're getting inflationary growth, altogether more difficult when you've got deflation. So what we've seen is a cyclical effect, an effect around a competitor or competitors doing very well in recessionary times, forcing other players to reduce their prices. And we've seen really strong commodity cost reductions affecting the price of food. And I think it would be a fair assumption to make that when the economy gets better, when we get a different kind of balance in commodities, we will see a degree of inflation come back. But, and this is the most important point in a way, these times differ because it's not just about a cycle of events. It's about structural change in the way that people are buying and consuming food. So, the IGD put out some figures recently, and what they said is that over the course of the next 5 years, their expectation is that hypermarkets, the Tesco Extras, the big boxes, will see a sales decline of around 4%. That in supermarkets, sales will be flat. Now, you might not think that's too much of a challenge, but when you've got cost inflation in wages and other utilities and business rates that are going to be around 5%, you're going to have to find a lot of savings in your cost base in those operations in order to offset the impact of those falling volumes in hypermarkets and supermarkets. But at the same time, the IGD predicted that total food sales in the UK would grow by 16%. The reason that they're going to grow by 16% is that the discounters are now committed to a course of growth that will see them double their market share over the course of the next 5 years. We're likely to see a growth in convenience retailing of about a third. And convenience retailing isn't just about the convenience shops you use, it's the fact that customers are choosing to shop more frequently. So now, on average, people are shopping 3.5 times a week for food, a very different picture to what was happening in the 1970s and the 1980s, which has led me and others to comment that the big weekly food shop is a thing of the past. Now, a quarter of shoppers are going to visit convenience shops on a daily basis, and the vast majority of people do not travel to buy their food. 8 out of 10 will buy their food within a mile of where they live and work. All of that is fueling a trend towards convenience. Now, that's having one other very dramatic effect, and it's this: that over the course of the last 5 years, food waste has dropped by roughly 20%, according to RAP. So people are buying less food. Fewer items are going in a basket. In the case of Waitrose, it's about one fewer item per shopping trip, and that's being replicated across all the food retailers. The next big change is one that you will be very aware of, and that's the growth of online and technology. Online sales for food this year are going to be circa £8 billion, and that's going to be just under 5% of all food sales. If you go back just a few years, 2009, it was about 2% of sales. The prediction is that it will grow to about £16 to £20 billion worth of sales in the next 5 years. That's a lot of footfall that's coming out of those large supermarket boxes. And then lastly, we're seeing the rapid rise of eating out. It seems that every high street now has a Starbucks and a Costa. You can't go anywhere without seeing them. And people are swapping eating at home, breakfast, lunch, dinner, for eating on the hoof, far more than they ever did. Over the last 2 years alone, 15% more people are eating out on a weekly basis. That's 19 million people compared to 17 million people just 2 years ago. So what we have is a perfect storm in food retailing. A lot that you'll read in the papers will say there's a really easy answer to all of this. All the supermarkets need to do is cut their prices. But frankly, that isn't the answer. That might solve one of the short-term problems. But you've also got to think about online, convenience shopping, people eating out, and also the fact that people are more conscious about what they buy and what they waste. So what's the response to that? Well, you'll see all of the other supermarkets over the course of the next few months announce new strategic reviews, and they're going to tell you what their solution is. I'd just like to spend a few moments talking to you about what the Waitrose strategic response is to those issues. And to do that, I've got to put the Waitrose business into context, because as you know, Waitrose is part of the John Lewis Partnership. Speed and Lewis, who founded the partnership, bought Waitrose in 1937. Waitrose was originally set up by Mr. Waite, Mr. Rose and Mr. Taylor. Mr. Taylor was the accountant, which is why it's called Waitrose. It was a very successful small grocery shop and was taken on by the partnership in 1937. Now, Speedon was a very unique man. He had a riding accident in 1919. He fell off his horse in Hyde Park and he took a year to convalesce. During that time, he was horrified to learn that the salary for himself, his brother and his father was more than all the people that worked in John Lewis and Oxford Street and Peter Jones in Sloane Square at that time. And he was pretty horrified with that. At the same time, he went to visit a number of workers in the business who were off sick and wasn't particularly comfortable with the conditions they lived in. In the air at that time, you'll know, there was a lot of talk about communism, the Marxists and the Bolsheviks taking over. And for all of those reasons, he sat back and he reflected on what kind of business he wanted to own and he wanted to run. And it culminated in 1929, after his father had died, with Speed and Lewis putting all the shares of the business in trust for the benefit of all of the workers. And we became a co-owned business then. But what was remarkable about Speedon was that the mission that he set for the organisation. If you work for a PLC, you will know that your raison d'etre is to maximise shareholder value. That's why you go to work every day. Speedon had a very different idea. His idea was that the reason we come to work is to promote the happiness of the people that work in our business. And there are only two other places that I know of in the world where happiness could be defined as a mission statement. One is the American Constitution, which talks about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And the other is the King of Bhutan, who wishes happiness on his people. And the third is the John Lewis Partnership. So when your ambition is the happiness of the people in your organisation, you have to take a very different view to the changes that are happening in the marketplace. The first thing you recognise is it's through your people that you will get through that change. We believe in a formula that was defined by the Harvard Business School as employee, customer, profit, service profit is what they call it. We call it partner service profit. And what we believe is if you look after your people and you put them first, then they will stay with you longer, they will be more productive, you'll invest in more training, they will be more committed. Because of that, your customers will get better service, and because of that, your customers will be more profitable. It's a very simple model. And therefore, what we have to think about is the happiness of our partners, their security, their employment through this time of huge change. And so at the heart of our strategy to deal with these changes is to make sure that we can maintain the volumes in our core shops. That all of those people who are working in our shops today are going to have enough volume of trade coming through the door that we can keep them in gainful employment. Now, the nature of their jobs may have to change, but our commitment is to absolutely try and do that. So there's a number of things that we've done. The first thing that we've done is we've looked at the services that we offer to our customers in our shops in order to drive more volume. So we've got click and collect with John Lewis. 81% of all John Lewis's click and collect trade is now through Waitrose branches. We offer flower wrapping, we offer dry cleaning. And we will, over the course of time, offer our customers more services so we become a very handy one-stop shop for them. The second thing we've done is we've looked at our assortments. We've looked at things that Waitrose could sell and be very credible in. We don't think clothing's for us, as some of our competitors do, but we do, for instance, think horticulture is something that we can do really well. And over the course of the last year and a half, 215 of our shops now sell plants outside. We've got a fantastic, this isn't a promotion, by the way, we've got a fantastic website which is supported by Alan Titchmarsh, and we believe that we can really add something for our customers in that particular field. The other big move we've made is a move into hospitality and food service. 130 of our 320 shops now have cafes, but we're also experimenting with what we call grazing. So if you go into our shops, you'll be able to go to the patisserie counter or the deli counter or the fruit and veg department and buy a fresh juice that's freshly made for you, or to buy a cake and a coffee. And so what we're encouraging is for customers to see our shops in a very different way, not just places to buy food to take home and prepare, but places where they actually want to come and eat and enjoy some fantastic products. And then, of course, we've grown our online business. Sales were up by 53% in the first half year. The market grew by about 20%. We've trebled the amount of delivery capacity that we're offering from our shops. And then we started a whole host of new ventures. Only the other week, we launched a pets website. We don't sell live pets, we sell pets accessories, but for whatever reason, the trade decides to call it pets. Our wine cellar is fantastic, and if you go to our wine cellar now, you can click on bottles of wines that we couldn't hope to stock in our branches, the range is so wide, and you can either have it delivered to home or you can have it click and collected from our shops. We've also put collection lockers in tube stations, railway stations and also airports to try and make it much easier for people to collect goods at a place and a time that it's convenient for them. And then you might have heard about our launch into My Waitrose, which is our affinity card. We give our customers a free cup of coffee whenever they go shopping, one or two nods, I hope you like it. We also give our customers a free newspaper. And the thought there was what we wanted to do is something very different to everyone else. It was about a random act of kindness. I remember I used to commute into London every day from Pangbourne Station, and there was a rather wonderful lady who used to sell the tickets called Jackie. And Jackie had done the job for a rather long time and had become perhaps a little stern in her approach. But I made it my business to get to know Jackie. And I can remember one day going and getting a ticket from her, and she said, "I've been on holiday to Cuba, and I've brought you something back." And she rolled a cigar under the counter for me with my ticket. And I said to her, "That's incredibly kind." And I have to say, up until that moment, I didn't have the best feelings towards First Great Western. But after that, I felt amazingly warm towards them. And it was that notion, that random act of kindness. And so what we did is we said to ourselves, how do we build that relationship with our customers? What can we do? So we give coffee, we give newspapers. Last year, if you were lucky enough to shop with us in the week before Father's Day, we gave you a free large Toblerone. But we try to do all kinds of things to engage with our customers in a different way. I'm glad to say now we have 5 million members of My Waitrose, and we're giving away over 1 million cups of ethically sourced fair trade tea and coffee on a weekly basis. So it's become a huge hit. We've had to do a lot on price, so our prices is much sharper, and we've had to think about the efficiencies within our business in order to do that. But what I'm most pleased about is that that has not been at the expense of us having a large redundancy program and losing partners from our branch. We've been able to create, through all of those things, enough momentum, enough added trade, that we've been able to keep partners employed. We've invested in learning and progression. We've rolled out iPads to every manager in our branch, every specialist in our branch, so that they are technologically linked and we get the very best communication and collaboration. We haven't stinted on our community commitments. We give 75,000 hours of partner time a year to go and volunteer for local good causes. And for those of you who've been in our shops and put a little green token in a box, we've given now £14 million to good causes over the course of the last 5 years. So as well as looking after our customers and looking after our partners, we've wanted to make sure we continue to look after the communities in which we traded. And the same goes for our suppliers. There is a great danger when your business is under pressure that the way you look to square things is by putting a lot of pressure on your supply base. I'm very pleased with the fact that we haven't done that. When beef prices were falling, those of you who know about the cattle market, beef prices were falling very sharply at the start of this year and last year. What we did is we gave a guaranteed price to our beef farmers so that they could continue to farm with confidence that they would get a return on their investment. And we've done exactly the same with milk. Milk prices have crashed in the market. Everywhere now it's £1 for 4 pints of milk, but we've guaranteed our farmers the same price as we had before. So through all of that, what we've tried to make sure is the values that Speedon set out for our business right at the start, that we should do whatever we do with kindness and humanity. He liked to say that the partnership was wholly and solely created to make the world a little bit better and a little bit more decent. And I hope that through these challenging times, what we've done is tried to make sure that we stay true to those values in the way we looked after our customers, our partners, our communities, and also to our suppliers. I just want to end with one last thought. And it goes back to 25 years ago now and the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989. And that was followed by, as many of you will know, the Velvet Revolution in Czechoslovakia, which was concluded in the January, just 3 months after the Berlin Wall came down. And at the time, Václav Havel, the president of Czechoslovakia, was asked to go and speak to the House of Senate and the House of Representatives in Washington. And at the time, there was a lot of triumphalism in America. There was a very strong feeling that communism had been defeated and the American way had won, capitalism had won. And Harville was taken to talk about that, to talk about the defeat of communism, how he felt. And he gave an amazingly powerful speech. I would recommend it to any of you who want to read it. And in the speech, and I'll paraphrase, he says that although fascism was defeated in that century, and although communism was defeated in that century, it would be wrong to assume that capitalism had won, and capitalism in an unconstrained way was the answer. And he talked about the power of humanity, and he talked about the power of the individual, and the power of the individual to make decisions that were based on the right thing to do, and that individuals would ultimately be judged by a higher being, and that actually responsibility to yourself to do the right thing was more powerful than any responsibility you might feel to your friends or your family or your business. The thought that I have, and I want to leave you with, is that the last 6 years, I think, have made everybody think very differently about the country we live in and the world that we live in and the pressures and the changes that we've faced. There's a lot of talk now about the gap between those that the most have and those that the least have. And I suspect the tensions that are only going to grow. Whichever party comes into power next year, we still have huge issues around the size of our national debt and the size of public spending. And what I would commend to you is an organisation like the Partnership that has genuinely tried to square the interests of its partners in terms of their well-being and happiness, and yet thrived in probably the most aggressive and commercial of worlds. Thank you very much indeed.
Mark, thank you very much indeed for that presentation. And we will thank you properly at the end, but we obviously have time for a few questions now. And I'd just like to explain a little bit about the rules or the way things are going to work in terms of questions. Rules sounds a bit hard. But obviously we have in the room a number of guests, distinguished guests and members. And we also, as you know, have our satellite regional events, our street parties. So in order to make sure that we're also reflecting the views and the questions from those separate events, we've given instructions to the reception. The reception is about how they can actually communicate and bring questions to Mark. So I will have one of the microphones here in order to be able to ask the questions that come into us, hopefully that we get from the receptions. But obviously you're also welcome to ask questions here from the reception here tonight. If I could just ask one question just to start us off, please. And that really is around, you mentioned almost as a sort of off-the-cuff remark about the ethical traded, fair trade coffee that you have. And we've talked a lot today about the customers and the partners, but in terms of the supply chain, how important and how do you go about ensuring that the ethics go right the way through the supply chain?
When I read my degree, like many of you I suspect here, I had a choice to either read it as a BA or a BSc. The difference was, as an archaeologist, as a BA, you dug things up and you drew them and you measured the depth and then you gave them a terminus postquem or a terminus antiquem date, which means that with something else in the structure around it, like a coin, you could make the case that the pot was either older or younger than the coin and give it a date. If you did a BSc, what you would do is you'd find the pot, you'd put it in a kiln, and you would use all kinds of scientific methods to date it against the atoms and the carbon that you happened to find on it. I chose the art route, and therefore in answering these kind of questions, I tend to take more of an art form to reply. So that's a very long-winded way of saying. So there are two mechanisms for doing it. One is very mathematical and very scientific. So we engage ETI, we engage others to go around and to check. That's one way of doing it, and it's very much the stick. The way that I much prefer is the carrot. I much prefer working with suppliers for a long time so that they understand our culture and our requirements. So let me paint a picture of the difference between what we might do and what somebody else might do. In another organization, if a buyer is buying a certain product for a particular length of time, the management will get very nervous that there is too close a relationship building between the supplier and the buyer, and therefore the toughest negotiation cannot be had, so the buyers need to move. And they'll be rotated around on a regular basis. Our view is the longer a buyer can stay in place and build a relationship with the supplier and understand how they work and what they do, the better the relationship and the deal for Waitrose. So the best way in which we manage that is to try and secure long-term relationships with our suppliers. Now, the weakness of that is you could say that commercially we might lose out. We're not being tough enough. We ought to be repitching our business all the time. And we do an element of that. To be fair, we do that. We make sure that we are paying fair prices. But our premise is we want to build long and sustained relationships with suppliers. And through doing that, we can ensure that they have the very highest standards that we feel comfortable with and vice versa. Sorry, that's a very long-winded answer to your question.
Thank you very much. Does anyone else in the room have any question for Mark?
Thank you. So it's Tracy Oates from DNVGL. So thank you for your lecture. It was great. Just wondered, building on that, what you think the biggest sustainability challenge your company and your sector does face. You know, we hear a lot about population increasing to 9 billion to 2050 and increase in food production to 60%, and how you can respond to that under this kind of all the constraints of cheaper pricing and the other kind of challenges there are. Thank you.
Well, I mean, you're right, it's a real challenge. Everybody in this room knows all the statistics about what's happening with water, what's happening with population, what's happening with urbanisation, and I won't bore you with that because you all know it. What you're also seeing now is an increased amount of south-south trade and not south-north trade. That's going to be a major factor. You all know about the Chinese buying up tracts of Africa, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So our approach to that is to say, well, frankly, we've got to source more from the United Kingdom, and we've got to make sure that we have secure long-term relationships with suppliers outside the United Kingdom. So we have four CSR commitments. One of them is championing British. 70% of the produce that we sell is British. We make sure that all of our protein, with the exception of some New Zealand lamb when it's in season there, but our lamb is out of season here, all of our protein is British. Did you know that a third of all of the English wine sold in the United Kingdom is sold in Waitrose? So we're very committed to a local supply base because we feel the traceability is better and our ability to work with farmers is better. We have a chair in sustainable agriculture at Aberystwyth University. We're very pleased with that. They're doing a lot of excellent work for us. They did a great piece of work on upland farming, actually, quite recently. So all of that's trying there to help our farmers and other farmers be more sustainable and profitable in the United Kingdom. So a range of things that we do.
Can I just ask? I'm just going to ask one question from one of our branches, and then I'll come to you, sir. This is a question, believe it or not, from Northern Ireland, and they're asking, when is Waitrose coming to Northern Ireland?
well, we will come to Northern Ireland. I mean, we have been over there in recent times. We have looked at sites, so it's a question of when, not if. But at the moment, our development plan is pretty full for the next 3 years, but who knows after that.
Well, hopefully there's a cheer from that room, even if we can't hear it. Thank you. We have a question here. I'm just going to pass the microphone.
Thank you. Kurt Berger. I've got great admiration for Waitrose's philosophy, and this is certainly not a question directed necessarily at you, but my wife comes home from shopping in a time of deflation of vegetable prices, and she says, every time I go, the price has gone up. and you know, why isn't the deflation being passed on generally as rapidly as possible?
So if your wife buys milk, a year ago she'd have been paying £1.45 for 4 pints of milk, she'll now be paying £1. A year ago, your wife would have been paying about 14% more for potatoes, 9% more for carrots. The price of our chicken has come down. Our beef, we've been selling our beef over the last few months for a third off on our counters. So there is massive deflation. Now, what's probably happening is we sell such wonderful things. She's putting a few extra things in the basket. So the basket price is going up, but we're all seeing deflation. Average item price in Waitrose is down, and it is in all of the supermarkets.
That was also a very similar question to one that was posed from Henry and Thames, so I've saved you that one. I appreciate this is a science question, not an art question here, but how can retailers improve nutrition for consumers? And that comes from Martin Keeley. Doesn't say where from, but...
Okay. I think we do. I think that the relationship with the government is good. I think if you look at what we've done on front of pack with labelling, it's good. I only had a meeting yesterday with Maura Howie, who's the advises us on diet and nutrition. We were doing a lot of work with diets for elderly customers. So we were looking at particularly what we can do for them in terms of pack size, in terms of protein intake. So I think a lot happens from my perspective. I sit on the board of the IGD, and regularly we talk about nutrition and health. They're hot topics for us. But I'd be interested to know from the person who asked the question, what do they think we're not doing and what more do they think we can do?
So, Martin, if you're listening to that, if you have a second response, please do send that back in to us.
Email me.
Or email separately, of course. Thank you. Do we have any more questions in the room before I move on to any others from the reception? There's one right at the back. It's Clive. Just going to... We have
Thompson,
a mic.
Thompson, Owl Control Laboratories. How are you handling the issue of allergen-free foods? How are you handling the issue of allergen-free foods? They're going right up the agenda at the moment.
Well, if I'm honest, not particularly well. If you look in Waitrose, we have a free-from section, and we try to give customers advice. But what we find is that, and you'll know this better than anyone, our customers are becoming more and more aware about diet and health and what they can and can't eat. And they want more help and support from the supermarkets. So one of the things that we're trialling at the moment is we're trialling work with local GPs. We're inviting somebody from the local GP's office to come into a Waitrose for an hour or two of an evening to help people with dietary advice. That seems to be working really well, actually. We're getting a lot of subscribers to do that. If you go and look at our online site, there's a massive information there about our products. What's in and what's out. I would confess that at labelling it in branch, we're not as good as we could be. You've got to look very hard at packs to see things. And our free from section is good, but it's quite hidden and could be much broader. But what you've touched on, I think, is one of the huge growth areas for certainly our business and I suspect the other supermarkets, which is how do we help customers more with choices around diet, allergies, etc. I think there's a lot more we can do.
I'm going to pose a question from Harper Adams, and that is, will the price competition from discounters further endanger British farmers?
Gosh, I wish I knew the answer to that. I think it's a really hard question to answer, and to be honest, I think it's up to the farmers to decide. I worry at the moment that there could be huge pressure. I'm really pleased we put a floor in for beef and a floor in for milk, and the industry is now settled around those prices. I think it's a worry. I'm a great believer that you get what you pay for. I think that the ticket in front of goods tends to be the very best guide you're ever going to get around the quality and the value. But I do worry that in moments of madness, people will slash prices and think about the consequences later on the supply chain. So I would like to say I don't think so, but I think what you've seen from milk and maybe in other commodities leads you to the belief that there will be more and more pressure along the whole supply chain, which I think is very unwelcome. I've always taken the view that the consumer doesn't fully understand the time and the energy that goes into producing the food that goes on their table. The fact that you can buy 4 pints of milk for £1 is completely ridiculous. But that's where the market has moved to. I talked at a fair trade conference and I was asked about the price of bananas, which have crashed again. And we only buy fair trade bananas. They come from a set number of growers, mainly in St. Lucia. And the questioner said to me, it's immoral, Waitrose, that you have now slashed the price of your bananas because it doesn't set the right tone for the growers. What I explained to the questioner was that although we've cut the price, we take the profit hit, we still pay the supplier the same amount of money. But if we kept the price high and our volumes went down by 10%, the supplier would be worse off. So that's the moral dilemma you face. Do you follow the market, keep the volumes up and keep your suppliers in business? Or do you put the price where it was, lose the volumes, and then they're struggling, but you're kind of okay, Jack, because your margins are all right. So the view we've taken in Waitrose is that you've got to match on KVIs. You just can't charge more for milk and bananas. People know the price of that, and they will genuinely make a shopping decision, a lot of people, based on that price. So that's why the industry is under so much pressure at the moment, as I was saying earlier.
We're a victim of our own success, in a way. And as an institute interested in food science and technology, a lot of that technology is hidden from the consumers, I think, and as a result of that, they come in to buy their produce with a big disconnect between how it's produced and what they see on the shelf. So I think you're right that it's quite amazing. I mean, I come from a non-food science background, and when I first came into the food sector, the wonders of what happens to get stuff on the shelves was quite amazing to me. But that does work against us in terms of showing exactly the complexity of the food supply chain.
Yeah, I agree.
Yeah. Here's one for your, I don't know how far into the future your crystal ball goes, but Henley on Thames would like to know what Waitrose would look like, it will be doing in 2037. I need to do the arithmetic on that one first.
Years,
I think.
who knows? I'd like to think that we were even better at doing what we were doing today. We have what we call a monastic expansion policy. That is, we only grow our business as quickly as we can grow the people that understand the nature and the culture of our business. So what you won't see Waitrose do is go out and buy 100 supermarkets from a competitor or take over Sainsbury's. What you'll see Waitrose do is grow steadily year after year after year after year. I often joke, and it's a rather bad joke, that at the end of the world there'll be cockroaches and Waitrose. You know, we just don't want to take risks. We don't want to take risk financially. We're very prudent with our money and our expansion. We want to grow in a sustained rate. My sole job, really, is to make sure that I hand over the stewardship of the business to whoever takes over from me in a fit state for them to then take it forward for the next generation. So there is no thought that by 2037 we're going to be, you know, 50 billion and the biggest food retailer in the Europe. And I mean, that's just not how our minds work. It's just about every year, can we make our business better for the partners that work in it? Can we make it more sustainable for the future? Can we do a better job for our customers? So we're really grounded in just doing things to the best of our ability day in, day out.
Good answer. Are you okay to take just a couple more questions?
Yeah, no, okay, that's fine.
Have we got any more questions in the room? We have one over here. I'm just going to...
Hi, good evening, Ian Noble. Thank you for the talk. If I could just perhaps redirect from the question before last, when we were getting a little bit kind of doom and gloom. Rather than the crystal ball, if I was to give you a magic wand, taking your perspective on values and the pressures I think we all see and feel from discounters and consumers on price, how would you recast the world?
The world?
For values. Yes, well, why not? But specifically for food within the context of the values that Waitrose proposes.
Okay. I would love a world where the customer clearly understands the trade-offs they're making when they buy a product, and that they have visibility of what they're buying and why they're buying it. Because at the moment, I suspect there is a lot of smoke and mirrors. I read something in the paper, interestingly, about Aldi. I don't know if you saw it, but there was a big fuss about the fact that Aldi were going to sell beluga caviar, and it was going to be $9.99 for 20 grams. And people are saying that this is absolutely remarkable. How are they going to do this? You know, it costs £2,500 for a kilo at wholesale. So how at retail could you sell such amazing things? And it was splashed over all the papers. And I have to say, I sat back and I thought, gosh, that's a heck of a good buy. But a journalist, I think it was in The Observer, 2 weeks ago, said that it actually isn't beluga caviar. It's from China, it comes in jars, it's ambient, and £9.99 is what it's worth. And so for me, there's a real honesty about the consumer buying that product, knowing what they're buying, as opposed to somebody thinking that they're getting something that's very special and very different. It goes back to the point I was making earlier about you get what you pay for. And I think that there is a great danger that sometimes the consumer could be duped into thinking that they're getting something that's different or better than they really think they're getting. So going back to your point, John, I'd love people to know why, if they spend a little bit extra on a piece of beef, it's genuinely worth it, because of the welfare conditions, because of the breeding, because of the way the meat's been prepared, because of the way the meat's been stored. If customers knew that, I think they would pay more for their food. You know, if you look at the UK, 9% of disposable income goes on food, France 15%, Italy 20%. You know, there are other cultures where people understand better the link between quality and freshness and price, whereas what we become obsessed by is the lowest price. There's you'll all know the industry magazine, The Grocer. The measure of price in that is who can knock out 35 lines at the cheapest every week. I mean, I don't think it's hard to sell cheap food. I don't think it's hard to go and buy, well, I won't name it, but it's not hard to go and do that. You know, if our measure of success is who can sell the cheapest, I think we're selling ourselves short. You never see in what car, cheapest car, most expensive car. It's outrageous that a Bentley costs 120 while an X costs 10,000. I mean, everyone would say, well, that's mad. Of course the Bentley costs, you know, 10 times more if you look at the engineering and the design. But funny enough, on food, people don't say that. They say, oh, it's a steak. You know, it's a steak and it's £2 cheaper there. But it's not the same. And so I think the job that we have to do, those of us in the know, we have to take the time, if I had the magic wand, to just get people to understand what they're buying, what they're paying for, and the fact that for many people, that bit extra is worth it. It also quite amazes me that you see people queuing out of the door in coffee shops, paying £2.50 for a cup of coffee, and yet quibbling over the fact that a £100 shopping basket might be £1 more in one supermarket than another. I mean, it makes no sense. But anyway, that's where we seem to have got ourselves as a society at the moment, and if I had a wish, it would be that.
Okay, I'm going to... there are two questions sort of combined here, and I think I'm going to take this as the last question. So the questions come from Bristol, and another one from Martin Keeley, but again, not sure where he's from, which is along the lines of, why do you think other retailers don't follow the Waitrose plan? And in a sense, the same sort of question, do you think others are likely to start working with the similar core values to improve their own offering?
So I do see a lot of things happening in other retailers about fair trade, a lot of great work. I see a lot of good work around animal welfare. So I do see things elsewhere, which I would applaud. I think they're right in terms of the long-term sustainability of the United Kingdom. I think one of the great advantages for me in running Waitrose is that I can genuinely take a long-term view. What I'm thinking about is the partners in the business today, what do we have to do to secure their employment and make sure the business is successful for the long term? And frankly, Waitrose isn't in the spotlight in terms of the press. I mean, we get comments, but we don't get the kind of scrutiny that the PLCs get because people have invested in them in a different kind of way. And therefore, that gives us a degree of time to say, look, this is the direction we need to go in, and this is how we're going to get there. If you're running one of the publicly quoted food businesses, you know, every quarter you're being grilled on your numbers. Every quarter somebody wants to see a turnaround. The average tenure of a chief executive in the UK, in the United Kingdom, is about 4 years. The average tenure of a chief executive in America is now 2 years. I mean, what can you do in 2 years? You know, if you go into a new company, just to understand your management team, what your business does, you know, there isn't the time. It's become like football management. And so what you have to feel for is these individuals going in who are being asked by the press in months to say, what's your strategy? How are you going to turn around the company? And then, of course, there's a great desire from those individuals to either sort of make the profits that they are inheriting as bad as they can so they look as good as they can in year two, or to get rid of the management team so they can bring in their people because they think their people will be able to implement a strategy more quickly. And frankly, it's a nonsense. It's a complete nonsense. No individual makes a difference in a company over a year or 2 years. I mean, you have to sit down with your team, a plan over 5 and 10 years. So, in, you know, what will our competitors do? I think they will have to respond pretty immediately to what shareholders want, or shareholders will pull their money out and put it elsewhere. You know, are they prepared to see profits drop like a stone while they re-engineer the business and do things in a different way? I'm not convinced they will. And that makes it very, very hard for them. So I have nothing but admiration and a degree of sympathy for all those people who are running the large food retail businesses at the moment. I think it's incredibly difficult for them because, for the reasons I explained, we've not only got cyclical pressures, we've got structural change pressures. And they come along once every 60 years and they need 5 years, 10 years to work through. I mean, you can't deal with these things quickly, particularly if you've already got a really big business that's aligned to the way people used to shop, not aligned to the way that people are going to shop now and going forward. So they have my admiration. I wouldn't want to do it for the world.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you very much for all those very candid answers. Really appreciate that. I'm going to just pass you over to Margaret to say a few last words. Thank you.
Mark, thank you so very much for tonight. It's a fascinating lecture into the insight of Waitrose. I'm delighted to hear that you're going to think about coming to Northern Ireland very soon. I won't let you forget that. I think as the Institute, sometimes we focus very much on the production and processing side and forget it's a very long supply chain, and the retail sector is very important. So thank you very much. And I think all the questions, and thanks to all the regions who sent in their questions as well. The technology worked obviously well. I have a small gift here for you. It was going to be Tesco's finest, but, it's actually, we have some special sparkling wine done for our Jubilee year, so you're very
thank
welcome
you
very to have
much
that.
Indeed. That's thank very, you very, so very much. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Thank you.
So just before we finish off and we sign off, I want to thank everybody all around the regions. I hope you found it interesting and that all the technology worked for you. And just before we go off and enjoy our party here, I want to plug for next year. Our spring conference is on the 23rd of April, so there's a date for your diary, 23rd of April, and the title is Food Safety in the Court of Public Opinion. So with that, I'm going to say goodbye to our regions and have a good party wherever you are. And we're going to have a good party here now because refreshments are being served in the room behind us. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.